I'll be with you in a moment.
As soon as I find my lighter. My little candle. My candle thing. So this would be story 33, I think. 33 or 34. I think it's 33. Whatever story it is, I'll figure it out. I wasn't even sure which story I was going to tell with this. These ghost stories, paranormal stories, they're not all ghost stories. I don't know what some of them are. I think I've got like 16 more that I want to tell. A couple I'm debating because kind of personal. It involves other people. I mean, how do you tell a story that involves somebody else? You know, maybe they don't want it told. Well, in this case, the person's deceased. So then I got to think, now I got to give some thought to it. But this story, all right, this story. Actually, I'm just going to get it out of the way. I'm going to talk about the most recent place a year and a half ago that I moved out of, trailer number 2. I lived there for 8 years. Sometimes alone, sometimes I wasn't. I mean, in flesh. I don't think I was ever alone there. And I'm going to just talk about that, trailer number 2. And story number 19, I talk about the paranormal activities around, outside the place. I'm not going to, See, I don't know how much to this to tell, because I don't want, well, if I don't give any names out, I don't know the legal ramifications, tell stories about with other people in it. I'll just tell a story, right? I don't mean anybody any disrespect or anything like that. Don't think anything will come of this. Well, I moved into this trailer, oh, about 8 or 9 years ago. And I've since moved out about a year and a half ago. And from the very start, I knew the place was haunted, inside and out. I won't recap the things I experienced outside of the trailer. If you want to hear about that, go to story 19. I think the first thing I noticed there, I will mention, was the black, sooty black cloud that was circling my place. And I saw it more than once. And if you watch story 19, I wasn't the only one that saw it. I had a friend, Amy. She was very spiritually inclined as well, sensitive, whatever you want to call it. And she definitely saw it. And I never told her about it, so... What do I tell? The inside of the place. A lot. There was so much stuff going on in there. Nothing that I ever felt threatened, except once. I'll just tell things that happened. I know the first time I stayed there, I actually was getting set up. I had a mattress on the floor in the living room. I was moving in. Spent my first night there. And something banged on the side of the wall, like outside, like somebody came up and went bam with their hand, really hard. You know, it was pretty loud. It sounded like somebody came up and hit the place with their hand. And at the time, there was about 2 or 3 feet of snow outside. It was pretty remote. I might as well have been on the North Pole. And when I looked outside, there was no footprints or anything. There were no large icicles that could have fallen. And it startled myself and my guest at the time pretty bad. And I jumped up and I rebuked it in the name of Jesus Christ and told it that it was not welcome there. And that was towards the front of the trailer. And it was a single wide. So another old single wide. And as I said, and I was angry, I said, "You are not welcome here in the name of Jesus Christ. You leave." And then it was bang. It was like it was going down the hall, pounding the wall, going down the hallway. About 2 times, bang, once, halfway down the trailer, then bang, all the way at the very end of it. Like it was punching the wall. That was pretty messed up. There was all kinds of, I think all kinds of spirits in that place. That place was like, I don't claim to know these things. It was like a vortex. I don't know what it is. There were animals, people, angry people, other type of people. It was all kinds of stuff there. It's like a, I don't know what it was about that area. I don't know if anybody else ever experienced it. I asked my landlord, and he said his son lived there 3 years. He never had anything happen. There's a downside to that story. I'll get to it towards the end of this. One time it was helpful. When I played guitar then, before I injured my hands and then started playing this accordion, I had a set of guitar strings, really good ones, nylon. I played classical guitar, finger style, classical, Bach, Mozart, whatever, Celtic, yeah, Chopin, yeah, whatever. And I couldn't find those strings anywhere. And they were high tension, they're expensive ones. Not that expensive, but really wanted them. Restring my guitar. Looked and looked and looked and looked and looked and looked and looked. For about 2 or 3 weeks, looking all over the place for these guitar strings, couldn't find them. Came home from work one day, and they're right in the middle of the floor, right in the middle of the floor in my bedroom. And I was the only person living there at the time. So that was kind of helpful, but still kind of creepy. One time, oh God, so much stuff happened there. There's no way. I know I did tell one story. I don't know about spiritual attachments. That happened inside there, where I actually saw a spirit come out of somebody, go into the floor, and then rematerialize as a ball of light and follow after that person in there. One time, the bed would shake. I'm in it alone, and the whole bed would shake like there's an earthquake. Or I used to think my washer might have been on a spin cycle because it was just a single wide, and the washing machine wasn't that far away. It was physically, it was probably about 15, 20 feet away from where my bed was, but the washing machine wasn't on. And this happened a lot when I was in the back sleeping. The whole everything would, and I'd get out of bed and think, what's going on? And nothing else is shaking, just the bed is visibly shaking. And this is like a queen size mattress that I had on cinder blocks, a lot of them, like 12 cinder blocks. So it was quite stable. Sorry. I'm still not used to talking in front of a phone camera, Yeah, that happened a lot. Things would shake. I remember once, this is scary. I was sleeping in the back, and I felt like I was suffocating, like, and I opened my eyes, and I saw a black, misty, looked like a puff of smoke. And it was trying to get into my mouth. And when I got up, it just went and it shot straight down and vanished through the floor. It was trying to enter my mouth as I was sleeping. And I later, and I looked and saw it, and it just came out and then went down and vanished. It couldn't make it into me, but it was trying to make it into me. I'm not making this up. One time I was in there sleeping, and I woke up in the middle of the night. And I can't explain this because I don't do this. I don't think I've ever done this. But I sat bolt from like deep sleep, sat bolt up and pointed at the door, and I said, "Damn you, you leave me alone." And the door was opening, and then it closed. Yeah. I figured that one out. I got up and said, I was just sleeping. I just bolted up, said, "Damn you, you leave me alone." Pointed right at the door. And like I said, the door was opening up slowly, and then it slowly closed. And what else? There's so many things that happened there. I didn't write any of this down. I really didn't like to talk about it. But yeah, these things still happen. That's nothing I look for or want to happen. It's very disruptive. And yes, I prayed over it, and some of my Christian friends prayed over it. My dear friend Amy told me, a very devout Catholic church that I'm entertaining, she told me how to pray for spiritual protection. And I did a lot of praying. Every night when I was going home there, I said a lot of prayers. Lord's Prayer, Hail Marys. Talking to God, asking for protection, visualizing His holy light shining down from heaven and encompassing my entire place. Just asking, Lord, let your light shine down and just flood my whole, the trailer and the property around it with your holy light. And, you know, I was able to go home and go to sleep and live fairly peaceful, all things considered. Like I said, I never felt threatened. This changes a bit, not for me. There was a dog, too. There was, seemed to be a spirit of a dog, and I have a dog, same dog I have now. And you'd hear him walking around, padding around, snuffing at the door. And one time I heard a dog really loud. I thought it was my dog. It sounded like it got hit by a car, like a stricken dog, a yelp and a howling and a whining, that like a dog that just got fatally, mortally wounded. And it wasn't my dog, because my dog was flipping out too, wondering where this was from. And I went outside instantly and looked around. There was no dog around there. It's not the only time this happened. So there seemed to be a spirit of a dog on the property. I'm not the only one to point this out. Then my girlfriend staying with me, and it didn't like her. That she started to have problems. I mean, she was, without getting too far into it, was sleeping in the living room, I in my bedroom. And I heard her get up and go down the hall and pass my room. I wasn't sleeping in the back room at this time. There's two bedrooms, bathroom, laundry room, and then one big room that was both living room and kitchen. And I didn't think anything of it. She went down, used the bathroom, and came back to the living room, sleeping on the couch. And the next, I heard, after she walked down and walked past my room, I didn't say anything to her. I was just laying there trying to get to sleep. And I heard a man say quite clearly, and I can imitate it. It's kind of no emotion, very flat. But this voice right next to my ear said, "The door." Just like that. "The door." That's just how it sounded. And I'm like, ugh, you know, ugh. I said a few prayers and went back to sleep, because this stuff was happening there a lot. It was getting kind of out of hand. Well, the next day she told me that when she came back from the bathroom, her bedclothes were all piled up in front of the door that night. She also said her cell phone went flying off the table and flew across the room that night. Well, she was having problems with it. And apparently, when things like that happen, I think that's their way of saying they want you out of the house. They want you gone. And I was working nights, and I used to pray for her in that place. She had a bad night one night where something was in her face growling, something very large, not human, not animal, she said, very large growling. And it was right in her face, and she backed out to leave the place. And it was growling in her face all the way out to her car, and she went to her parents. And yeah, that was probably pretty recent, actually. So I started getting worried that the things were taking a different turn there. And I think there was more than one spirit there and more than one type. But I don't claim to know these things. I just know what I experienced. I want to say, this is pretty shaky, that, well, there's something that happened there, but I'm not sure I want to tell it of it. Well, I found somebody on my property dead. Oh, I think they died of a heart attack. They were working on the property. And I'm not going to say any more about that. It was a tragic, very tragic thing. But you can imagine I was pretty looking forward to getting off that property and moving on. And eventually did moved out. And if I offend anybody, if by chance somebody watches this that knows who I'm talking about, please let me know. I'll take this video down, but I don't think that person would mind this. I don't mean any disrespect. Man, what else with that place? God, there's so much that happened there. I could just sit here and think about it and remember stuff. It's incredible. Pulled in the driveway one night. I have a girlfriend with me. We're sitting in front of the place, and we're both apprehensive about this place at this point in time. And we're just parked there, and the lights turn on and off. Porch, kitchen lights on, off, on, off, on, off while we're sitting there. They didn't do that. This isn't something these lights did. Just click off, click on, click off. And we're both like, eh. I looked over. She was scared. What am I forgetting? There's dark things that happen there. It's just, I don't know what to tell you. That's why, people go ghost hunting for this stuff. You don't want this stuff in your life. And I was able to deal with it because I knew that I was of a child of God and know to call on the Holy Spirit, and the name of Jesus Christ has authority, it's like a badge, vested authority, vested by the Trinity, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And I didn't entertain this stuff, but it happened in my life anyway. And along with the blessed things that happened to me in stories 1 through 15, 16, I'm telling them all. God allowed these things to happen to me for some reason. You better believe I did not want these things to happen. I like peace and quiet. Just a nice home. Home's supposed to be your refuge, your place to get away from the world, to rest, to calm down, your quiet place, or your place to be happy, whatever. It's not supposed to be with some invisible things that you don't know who or what their intentions are. You don't sleep. There's no peace when you have a house like that. Very little peace. It'll drive you to drink, honestly. Usually for me, I would say that personally, because I'm telling these stories, I'm gonna get to a story about a haunted house on Congress Street when I get to that story. That place was every day, every night there. And I'll tell you how I dealt with it. But it did, my drinking picked up. I started drinking, fortifying myself with a six pack or so at night. I had a few beers and I just didn't care anymore. I had a lot of things happen in that place. I got a bunch more stories. I kind of saved some of the big stuff for last. Like I said, I think I've got about 15 more stories to tell. And then after that, God willing, I just got my plans, but I don't know what God's plans are. I plan to go over some things that I've written down, quite a bit of things. Conclusions, suggestions, a little bit of speculative thought. Maybe we can bounce off each other. Really enjoy some of your writings, some of you that write to me regularly, either as a comment or if a couple of you email me. If I don't get back to you, it's not for some, it's not because I'm trying to disrespect you. For some reason, sometimes I don't usually get the message that I've had a comment, but I try to at least give you a thumbs up or acknowledgement. And some of you have some pretty deep and moving stories. I encourage you all to consider starting your own Christian, whatever your personal test, it might not be this stuff. Whatever your personal testimony is, to give glory to our God. And if you're a Christian, I'm not here to preach or anything, but I suppose in a way I am, but this is my story. Believe whatever you want. But these things happened to me. And I lived in that place, that trailer, for 8 years. And It wasn't always easy, and I did a lot of praying. And I never was harmed, really. But it didn't stop things from happening. Not, I was pretty much pretty apprehensive quite a bit, living out there alone. It was kind of crazy. And my mom said that, Tim, you with your background, what are you doing living out there in that place all by yourself? Good question. But it's not so easy when you don't have a lot of means to just move out of a place. And I've always said, and I've lived in some haunted places, if you start running from it, you might be running your whole life. You know, in my case, it's usually about a flip of a coin whether or not I'm in a place and it's going to have issues. Seems to me about three quarters of the time, maybe two thirds. I've lived in some places that were very quiet. Like really old places that had a lot of human history, very quiet, peaceful. Then I've lived in some places you wouldn't think would be spiritually active, like that, like a trailer. But that land had a lot of history behind it. That trailer wasn't the first place and won't be the last place sitting on that very beautiful piece of property. Very beautiful. But there were Indians before that that lived there long ago, lived there quite a while. That lived and died and called a home around the area, and never want to forget them. And there was a farmhouse there in the 1800s to about 1950. I believe it burned down in the 50s. And there was two other trailers there that I think had a fire. I'm not sure what the story is behind that. I couldn't find anything out about it. And then there was my place, and that place has since been tore down. It's gone. So I don't go looking. It doesn't exist anymore. It was junk. It was full of black mold. It wasn't healthy. Very nice people that I rented from. I really liked them a lot, and they were very good to me. Very good to me. I considered them for my friends. So that was a perk, and it was a beautiful area. It wasn't always creepy, but it was getting there. Let me see, am I forgetting anything about that place? Oh, a lot of bangs on the wall, banging on the wall. I'd have appliances turn on and off, doors open and close. You'd see them now and then. I'd see the black entities, that one that I told you the stuff, I don't need to repeat it. I'm probably forgetting a bunch of stuff, but you get the idea. So that's it for story. I think this is 33 or 34. I don't know which. It'll be on the title page. I just call it trailer number two, hauntings. Yeah, I don't know why I would share these things. They're not uplifting anybody. And there's plenty of this stuff all over YouTube. But it was part of my life experience, part of my testimony. And God allowed these things to happen to me. And I always said, I was really upset at points in my life that these things were allowed to happen to me because I didn't want them, none of it. And I always said, well, I'm going to take this haunting, this disruption in my life, I'm going to turn around somehow, I didn't know how, and use it to give glory to God. And I've got a plan. When I finish these stories, I got about 15 left. And a couple of them, a few of them are some big ones. I've got a plan and a challenge for anybody that wants to ghost hunt. Well, I'll say the challenge now. If you're a ghost hunter in any way, or you like to play with a Ouija board, or you like to do seances, or go into old places and look for things, I'll tell you right now, this is just part of my conclusion, but I challenge you to take the same amount of energy that you're putting into your ghost hunting and look for God, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Search them out. Search for them. Christ said, anybody knocks, you know, I enter, I don't know, I get that wrong, but if you look for them, you'll find them. And these stories that I'm telling you, they're creepy, maybe they're entertaining. I don't think I'm enlightening anybody with these, because I'm pretty sure you all know these things exist. I mean, the spirit realm is got a lot going on to it. Dark and light. Do a ghost hunt for the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Look for them. Look for a relationship. And you're not just going to have some scary, flippy story to tell, like these ghost stories. You're going to have a life-transforming event that's not only going to bless you, but it's going to bless people around you that you don't even know how it's going to bless them. Because there's a difference between these hokey ghost stories that I'm going to keep telling them and meeting up with the spirit of the Lord or his family, his angels, or others, you know, God and his family. You meet up with God, you find that spirit, God the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and it's going to be a much bigger event for you than any of these creepy stories that I'm relating to you on story 17 on up to present. And I got some more flippy stories to tell because it's interesting. I don't know. Obviously, it existed in Jesus Christ's time because his disciples believed in ghosts. And I never read anywhere where he told them ghosts don't exist. I mean, there's two or three places in the... I mean, they dealt with spirits all the time in the New Testament and in the Old Testament, but particularly the New Testament. Christ and his disciples dealt with demonic, familiar spirits. Two or three occasions, the disciples were afraid. They thought that Jesus was a ghost when he walked on water. They thought he was a ghost when he appeared to them after the crucifixion. And he never said to them, there's no such thing as ghost. You know, didn't I teach you? He never said that. When they thought he was a ghost, when they saw him walking out to their boat at night on the water, he said, don't be afraid. It's just me. He knew what they were thinking. Don't be afraid. It's just me. When he appeared, I think it was to Thomas. You can check this. After he was crucified and then risen, he showed up and he said something to the effect, I should write these verses down. I'll look them up. If I look them up, and I'll post them over this, you know, the verse at the end of this video. And he said, get me something to eat. Ghosts don't need food. But no, he didn't say there's no such thing as ghosts. But he didn't entertain it either, you know. So I guess that leaves a lot for you and I to try to figure out. So I don't think it's good to go looking for them. I really don't. Not only is it kind of it's very much discouraged in the Old Testament particularly, but you could get an attachment of something that could really turn your life inside out. Actually, there's another story. I forgot. No, I got 16 or 17. I just thought of something. My mother's house. The stories of that one. You could get an attachment. And it could, life's hard enough, you know. And you get a negative spiritual attachment, it's just going to make it all that much more harder on you. Where you're not going to have any peace. The only way you can find peace is, here's one thing with these. You get attachment, you draw closer to God, closer to God. These things have not, if anything, they've pushed me to God, not away from God. I had it going on so bad at times with some of the hauntings that I'd prayed ceaselessly, prayed and prayed and prayed, and read the Bible and hung crosses all over the place and went to church or to mass. And because, you know, you have a spiritual problem. You need God's the one that's going to be your defender. You better know him and seek him and pray for him, to him. But anybody that wants to ghost hunt or seek out spirits of other sorts for whatever reason, look for God, the Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Look diligently. Look deep. Read, search. Seek, you'll find him. And it's going to be a much bigger story than any of these hauntings, you know, any of them. So I guess all I really wanted to say in a story about, I was wondering how to tell it. Does it, I don't know, this happened fairly recently, and it was kind of upsetting time of my life, really. But I got that one out of the way. Trailer number two. Yeah. All right. Thank you. I'm gonna let him burn.